Tonight, we will be discussing confronting tragedy, the law enforcement unionism, and communities of color. First, I would like to introduce Carmen Berkeley. Carmen is a radical civil and labor rights activist, writer, and trainer who currently serves as the youngest director for the Civil, Human, and Women's Rights Department of the AFL-CIO in Washington. Juhun Kang. Juhun Kang, formerly of the Audre Lorde Project, is the executive director of Communities United for Police Reform. Eugene O'Donnell is a professor at the University of New York's John Jay College of Criminal Justice. He was an officer in the New York Police Department, a prosecutor with the district attorney's offices in Brooklyn and Queens, and a police academy instructor. And I am Ed Ott. I am a distinguished lecturer here in labor studies. The format tonight will be as follows. I will ask a few questions at the beginning. In your little packets here, and some of our staff have extras, are these cardboard questions. You can write your questions down, pass them to our staff members, identify yourselves in the back, Veronica, David, Laurie. They'll come up and collect them, and we will take the written questions, and I will ask them. You can put your name on them. I'll identify you. If you don't want your name on them, that's fine, too. In anticipation of similar questions, I will try and put some together where we congeal three or four together and try to keep it moving. So with that, let us begin. Police unionism, even within the labor movement and within the broader society, has always been controversial. Even such New Dealers as Franklin Roosevelt had serious issues with public sector workers, never mind uniformed services, having the right to organize and collectively bargain. By way of telling you a story, when I was at the Central Labor Council, there was actually a faction within the Patrolmen's Benevolent Association that was running for leadership of that organization on the basis that they would join the New York City Central Labor Council. It triggered a discussion within the top ranks of the New York City labor movement at the executive board of the council. And the council was badly divided. Basically, the public sector unions were very sympathetic to the idea. But most of the private sector unions, especially the construction trades, had real issues with them affiliating with the council. And while most of the leadership felt that they had an absolute right to organize, they asked the question, what would happen to the council and its unity if during a strike the police were asked to do what they do, and which triggered a discussion on the role of police in society vis-a-vis the labor question. I just put that out there to tell you that this is something that we have struggled with. Some of our earliest successful public sector organizing was, in fact, done by the Boston Police. They were the first ones to take job actions to defend their rights. But it remains controversial within the labor movement to this day. That being said, a huge piece of the unionized labor movement has issues with the community, or better said, the community has issues with us. It plays out in a variety of issues, certainly in policing, but it also plays out in areas of affordable housing, which are quite controversial, development in neighborhoods, and a host of other issues where often interests diverge. So in that context, here at Murphy, we have decided not to avoid the issue, but to try to have this discussion. We will go where it goes. Rules are as follows. Civility counts. Other than that, this is a safe space, open room. So I'm going to now introduce our first question. And the first question is going to go to Carmen. In view of the fact that the AFL-CIO represents both public sector workers, private sector workers, uniforms, and civilians. In view of all the events of the last couple of years on the question of policing in the community, what is the discussion at the top levels of the labor movement in Washington?
Well, first, thank you for having me. It's an honor to be here and to come from Washington, D.C. You know, I think that our president, Richard Trumka, said it best after Mike Brown was killed in St. Louis, and he said, our brother killed our sister's son. And, you know, I think that those words, you know, for people who are people feel this on both sides of the issue. People feel like, you know, thank goodness the AFL-CIO is actually, and unions are addressing the fact that we represent law enforcement and we represent someone like Leslie McSpadden, who is a United Food and Commercial worker. You know, a part of the conversation that we've had to have is, you know, oftentimes unions have been nervous about coming out and speaking about issues pertaining to, you know, racial justice, issues pertaining to implicit or explicit bias, because we do have law enforcement that are a part of the unions. But I also think that it's okay, like the labor movement never runs away from our issues. So for, you know, unions to basically, or for our federation to basically say, we don't want to touch this subject because we have, you know, we have police as a part of our membership, we don't see that as an adequate way to actually deal with this issue. We don't need to just call people out, we need to call them in. And I'll give you a quick example. We also work on criminal justice reform in my department at the AFL-CIO. And when we decided to start working on this issue, we said we can't leave out the corrections officers. How could we have a conversation about reforming criminal justice without bringing in law enforcement? And through that process, we have found so many common areas where we've talked a lot about safety. We've talked a lot about sentencing laws. We've talked about how can we as a community come together. So the conversation at the AFL is not just about, you know, bashing police, nor is it about saying that everything that the police are doing is right, because we don't take that position. But the position that we do take is, can we work with law enforcement to find common ground as we have in other areas of our work so that we can move forward and so that we can have a more trusting relationship?
Sure. Thank you. Gene, you know, in view of the events of the last 2 years, there's been all kinds of things said back and forth. One of the issues that's been raised by, often by police management personnel, but also by some of the representatives of police officers, is that police departments and police officers are being asked to do too much, and that the mission is getting confused. Would you comment on that?
Sure, and thanks, Ed, and I just want to thank the Murphy Institute, which does tremendous work, part of our overall CUNY family, and CUNY is the best. Anybody in the room has a $3,000 college education like I got. Some of you may have gotten the free one before me, before we were just talking about the U-Carry and how the Rockefellers shook down the city, and well, anyway, that's ancient history, but there you go. And I should say, good evening, brothers and sisters, as a member of proud member of PSC CUNY. So there's no question the police have too large responsibilities, and it's gonna be exacerbated because now you really don't have people who wanna be police people, so that's a whole other conversation we're gonna have. But the present moment issue is shown in the Bronx. That woman needed a doctor to helicopter in and help her. If the doctor wasn't there, she needed a social worker. If the social worker wasn't there, she needed EMS. If EMS wasn't there, she needed emergency service. Emergency service wasn't there, the cops were the only people to be there. Who's worse to send to a case of an emotionally disturbed person than armed police people? So you have an upside down system, and it's been an upside down system for a very long time, and that sort of best shows you. But you know, that is one of the issues. We've got to deal with addiction, we've got to deal with alcohol issues. Obviously, we've got to talk about real violent issues and stop ducking that, because there's a tendency to just, I have to say, what progressives do it, I mean, I guess everybody does it, but when you get to things like violent crime, there's just a fast forward. They don't have a conversation, disorder, just go through it. Just quickly said, I was in Philly last night. I picked up the Philadelphia papers. Just two real interesting things as we go forward. The approval rating of the Philadelphia Police Department, 72%. African-American approval rating of the police department, 60%. Latino approval rating of the police department in Philly, 60%. How does the esteem level of the police in the 60s? Esteem level of politicians, 10, right? And so why is it that the police are, again, they're imperfect. We can go into a whole long conversation. They are doers. They are actors. They're not, you know, they're not critics. They actually go and do things. And we need to right-size this, but, you know, Eleanor Bumpers was referenced. That's a third of a century ago. Half the city wasn't even alive. New York City Police Department since that time has responded to about 130 million calls, 138,000 emotionally disturbed calls a year, and very rarely is there a bad outcome. But, you know, we could talk about the media's role in all of this. It is a thing to see what the media has done. They've done it selectively. They've done it divisively. They've done it provocatively. They've done it acontextually. They've scrubbed the facts out of conversations, and they've created a lot of disinformation. And, you know, we can have that conversation.
Juan, same kind of question from the community point of view. The role of the police, is it confused?
I mean, I think first of all, I just want to thank the Murphy Institute for having me in this panel here tonight. The first thing I would say is that, is this not on? Do I not know how to work it? That's possible.
No, just put it closer to your mouth.
Strip for a moment. Better? Okay. So I think where I want to start is that there's one thing that I agree with that you've just said, which is that the officers should not have been first responders to Deborah Danner's home, the 66-year-old black woman who was killed in the Bronx this week. Absolutely should not have been first responders. And yes, Eleanor Bumpers was 32 years ago, but the NYPD system around this has actually not changed to the extent that it should have, given that it was 32 years ago. So I want to start with that in part, because when we say that are police officers' jobs too much, I think most people would agree with that for many different reasons. Right now, we're in a situation where, with the NYPD, the way in which the administration and the police commissioner are talking about the quote-unquote new community and neighborhood policing plan is actually having officers do things that we should actually make sure the communities are strong enough to do and to have those services without having to have officers play multiple roles. When we look at the federal budget right now, in the area of what we would consider kind of enforcement, and I would include corrections in that, police, courts, as well as immigration enforcement. There's probably, I think it was $206 billion at the 2012 budget count, $206 billion going into that. That's probably the equivalent of about 1 million living wage jobs. So we're making certain choices about how to allocate, or maybe we're not making those choices, but there are choices being made of how to allocate resources. And part of those allocations, when we look at New York City, is that we have many schools that don't have a guidance counselor, still don't have music or arts programs, but they have police. And so some of this is a prioritization issue that we need to think of systemically. It's not about are police good or bad necessarily. It's about the system that we've created, where we have a society that something like Deborah Danner being killed this week could have happened again. And it's not an isolated incident. Iman Morales was killed a few years ago, who was also actually naked on his ledge. An officer used a taser improperly. He fell off the ledge. He should have gotten help, shouldn't have been killed. And so these aren't completely isolated incidents, and I want to take that out of the narrative.
Terrific. Carmen, let's go back to you for a second. Richard Trump has been prominent in his discussions with white working class audiences, directly confronting the question of race. But part of, I think, what we're kind of struggling with here at Murphy is the police unions are unions. And in fact, their mission is collective bargaining. Are there any discussions that you're aware of going on? There are things that police unions could be encouraged to bargain for that would get at some of these systemic problems that might provide some alleviation on the police union side?
You know, probably one of the more challenging parts of my job is being a young black woman trying to talk to, you know, white folks about race. And, you know, I'd say that the approach that we've decided to take at the AFL-CIO is not one where people from Washington, D.C. go and talk to people in a profession that they're not even a part of about what they should be doing. So the approach that we decided to take is, let's actually talk about how race hurts all people. There's this assumption that race and racism only hurts people of color, and it's simply not true. If you think about right to work and where right to work comes from, it was actually a racist piece of legislation legislation where Vance Muse was trying to pit white workers against black workers. So instead, you know, when the Mike Brown incident happened, we said, okay, wait a minute. We actually have to talk about how implicit and explicit bias, how racism shows up in the labor movement, not just from the law enforcement perspective, but in general. So our approach was we decided to have a commission on racial and economic justice where we went to six different cities. And I mean, it was much more than that, but we did go to six different cities specifically to talk to union members, not only about how is what is the impact that law enforcement has on the community and not actually having a great relationship, but how do we as union members treat or not treat each other? When something racist happens on the job, how do we actually address those issues? So our approach at the AFL-CIO will never be that, you know, we're going to, you know, shake our hand and say, you know, police officers, you're absolutely wrong. But what we are doing is looking internally and saying, what are some of the policies and practices that we have that perpetuate race and racism? Because oftentimes people say to us, well, you should only be looking at collective bargaining. We should only be talking about economic issues. But let's face it, when I'm a black woman, I don't have the opportunity to just show up at work as a worker. I show up at work as a woman. I show up at work as a person of color. And so when someone does something racist or sexist towards me, that's how I'm responding. And so unfortunately, it's not just law enforcement that are dealing with these systemic issues on how does implicit bias affect how we do our job. It's actually all of us. So that's the approach that we've decided to take at the AFL-CIO. And my prayer is that in November, we will actually be able to release some of the results of that conversation. And we want to work with law enforcement, as we've done with the corrections officers, to figure out where is the common ground. Because if we're not working together and figuring out, okay, what are the two or three things we can work on in this city, in this state, we're going to continue to have conversations that go past each other.
Good. I'm going to try to take some questions from the audience at this point. Thank you for that. Zhuhan, we have a question for you. What support would you want to see from the larger labor movement?
Is it okay if I also just add something to what
Absolutely.
Carmen said? I really appreciated your comments. I also wanted to say your question around what would it make sense for labor, for law enforcement unions to be collectively bargaining for that could actually get at some of this. One of the issues is that in New York City, at least for the NYPD, is actually quotas. In terms of what many officers will say, that there are basically quotas of having to do tickets, or what used to be having to do stops. They don't say that anymore. But having to do tickets or having to do X number of arrests. And actually, police union leaders have spoken out about it, but what we hear all the time from rank and file is that nobody on the inside is actually pushing for that, truly, as a reform. And that could actually get to some of what is being experienced as disparate impact and disproportionate enforcement and racial profiling different communities if there weren't these kind of quotas that were being pursued. But the question that I didn't answer was, sorry.
What kind of support would you be looking for from the broader labor movement?
Yeah. I mean, right now we do get a good deal of support from a handful of labor unions. There are some of the usual suspects in terms of the New York City area, so 1199, 32BJ, for example, NYSNA, et cetera, around police accountability work. And so one example I would give is in 2013, the New York City Council passed two bills called the Community Safety Act. Labor actually played a very strong role in terms of helping to support not only the passage of the Community Safety Act, which were two bills to create a little bit of oversight, a basic oversight framework, I should say, for the of the NYPD, but they also, when it came down time to Mayor Bloomberg, our multi-billion-dollar mayor at the time, vetoed both of the bills, which meant that the council would have to vote to override the veto. And labor really played a role in terms of helping to make sure that we could hold council votes during that period. And that was incredibly helpful to us.
Thank you. Gene, you want to comment on it?
It's funny to hear about police reform. It's such a complex issue, but it is interesting. In this city, of course, we're super safe, so we can have all kinds of conversations that Chicago, Philly, Baltimore can't really have because people are up against the wall. If you put up murder in some of those cities, it will knock you on your It's incredible, the number of, you can't see whole neighborhoods in some parts of the country, and police disengagement's a huge issue. But since this is a politically savvy group, probably the biggest issue with police reform that happened in New York City was giving Michael Bloomberg a third term, right? Which the city council rolled over and did, as I recall, and gave Ray Kelly 12 years, which is a terrible dynamic for the police. Having failed to actually do their job over and over and over again, city council completely, you know, was a rubber stamp. They are now, most recently, now that the water has gone back to the sea, now they are declaring war on the police, which I just think is a big idea, big mistake in the long run. You have a job that nobody wants. You have a job, even the minimal, you can't get people to do even with minimal qualifications. Kerner Commission said that 50 years ago, cops should have a 4-year degree. That's laughably out of reach now. Almost no cops have a 4-year degree. People, you can't even get commissioners at this point. Chicago had a hard time getting a commissioner. We had a seminar of retirement for the other day. The cops were rolling out the door. And so I think we can have a holistic conversation. We can get a realistic conversation with people on the ground. By the way, the Philadelphia paper reports, catapulting to the top issue in Philly in the most recent poll, public safety. Because they know the cops have basically been taken out of proactivity, and it's scaring the hell out of people. And for people in the room who are in, you know, the labor movement, and I know it's always a challenge to be in touch with your membership. With all due respect, I think there are people that are not in touch with their membership. I know there are politicians that are not in touch with people in the community. You see that over and over again. You go to the community, they want to see the cops. They want them to be proactive. There is an elite that has taken this conversation over say that very briefly. I was going to work one day there on West 59th Street. I had a coffee in my hand. I sat for a nanosecond on the wall of one of these, you know, $12 million condominiums. And to talk about the doorman was on top of me within a second, right? Because that's totally, totally unacceptable in a $12 million condo. But to an elite that has taken this conversation totally out of the hands of ordinary people, you know, in places like public housing, people can suffer because in pursuit of a orthodoxy. Okay, and by the way, I'll try to be totally inconsistent here because I think this conversation is best when you're not consistent. But in pursuit of a orthodoxy that less policing is more, that all policing is abusive, that you know people speak for a community that's on the ground. I was on the ground a lot. I haven't been there in a while in the community. Community all surprises you when you hear them talk. I'll very briefly say the other day I did BBC Radio. You know, the BBC covers America, likes to take a dig at us every once in a while. There's an African-American woman on there from Chicago. Son was murdered, by the way. 80% of the people who murder people in Chicago never get caught. Imagine if that was happening on the campus at Brown or Harvard. And the police chief said, we can't arrest our way out of this. Imagine telling that to somebody in the room. Your daughter has gone off to school. We can't arrest our way out of this. And this woman said something I'm very familiar with hearing. She said, you know, I don't call politicians when I need help. I call the police when I need help. So, you know, we want to have a holistic conversation here. We have not talked about victims. Most crimes are not solved. So whether you're talking about domestic violence, hate crimes, all the issues that, you know, there are real serious issues. And then you get into an issue like cameras, which is your penultimate elitist issue. No way do I think, if you talk to people on the neighborhood, that's something that would ever be on the top of their list, because they know it's going to destroy the two-way relationship. But it's a panacea. It's been thrown out there. It is, again, grossly hurting the police business. The cops are flying out the door in L.A. They're flying out the door in Chicago. You can't even have a filing fee to have $30 filing fee to get people to sign up. Ambulatory people. Detroit gave a test, 8,000 people. They were able to find 200 people that would put on a uniform. Now, again, I know there are abolitionists in the room. I really can't say anything to abolitionists. I agree we need to go past where we are. I think there are ways to go past where we are. But there is a large, I did one of these on Wednesday, and I had two abolitionists on my left and my right. And you know, so I don't know what you say to those people. All I can say with all due respect, I don't think you're connected to the community. If you're an abolitionist, or at least go sell your abolitionism, the police are the rule of law. Let's be very clear on that. The reason that this city moves around, and I'm not as hardcore as I sound, but I'm just happen to be on this panel, but it is a reality that The fact that people pay their bill, don't push you onto the subway tracks, is the fact is the police are one call away. They get 5 million calls in this city. So if you're going to abolish them, please tell me who's going to go to 5 million calls and handle the issues that they handle.
Good. The audience is actually very timely. Taking your point on, it would be different if it was Brown University. we have a couple of questions which I'm going to put together. First one is, policing seems to prioritize property over people. It seems that this is an ideological framework that dehumanizes people for the protection of capital. Should we, and how do we address this policy? Along a similar vein, would the Bumper or Danner's outcome have been the same in an upper-class neighborhood rather than a working-class or minority one? And that's for all the panelists, so why don't you start us off?
Please? Sure. I'd like to take a poll. How many of you think that if there were a 66-year-old white woman on the Upper West Side in a building with a doorman that this would have happened in the same way that what just happened this week with you can raise your hand. This is a civil crowd, right? We said that safe space to have disagreement. Nobody. So I think actually there's pretty much unanimity
here.
Can I do
Donald Trump?
No.
There's reporting tonight that this lady, not only was she had problems
with really
her family.
You really are going to do Donald.
There's reporting tonight that she talked at least a little bit about Eleanor Bumpers, about the case. So was this a suicide by cop? It remains to be seen.
So
but this is why you have to wait for facts.
Right,
so one of
finish.
The issues that we see oftentimes after people are killed by police is that all sorts of stories come out from unsourced people at one police plaza in terms of what the victim may have said or sometimes actually false stories in terms of what the victim did. An example I'll use is Romarley Graham. How many of you have heard of Romarley Graham? That's great. 2012, I mean, it's not great that any of us had to hear his name this way. But in 2012, for people who don't know, Romarley Graham was 18 years old. He was in his home with his grandmother and his six-year-old brother. And he was shot and killed by police who entered his home without a warrant and without cause. And in that case, we're in a city right now where we're more than four and a half years afterwards. Officers still on modified duty. There has still not been firing of any officers in this case. And so the bigger picture around this that's sent to the community, I'm not talking about elites, I'm talking about the community, is that the officers are not going to be held accountable. This is just one case. I do want to address the comments earlier about elites thinking X, Y, and Z and not community members. What we know is every community is diverse. It doesn't matter what community we're talking about. There's going to be a diversity of opinion. But many communities in particular who are targeted in particular ways have a common experience. And so what I would actually say and disagree and push back on is that I'll give some examples. One of our leaders who lives in Bed-Stuy, it's probably about 20 years old right now, his name's Darian X. When he was 18, he'd already been stopped over 100 times. Never arrested, never ticketed, but had been stopped over 100 times for not doing anything wrong. So when you're having that kind of an experience, you're going to have certain feelings as to whether or not you're being treated fairly when you know other people who are not being treated that way at all. And when you see others in your same grouping, whether it's a racial category, whether it's sexual orientation and gender identity or what have you, being treated in a systemically unfair way, then that's part of the experience. So I really do want to push back on this idea that everybody in communities of color have one monolithic view, and I don't think that what you're describing as an elite view is necessarily is accurate. What I do agree with you on is that in terms of media, I don't think it's so much that the media is fooling all of us. I think that there's actually planted stories that are just wrong at times. I mean, we have too many examples of after police brutality cases, one police plaza actually saying things that are actually just false and come out as false months or years later.
I'm actually really happy that Donald Trump came up because I actually think that Donald Trump is such an incredible reminder that America hates people of color. Mm-hmm. You know, and that we make up excuses for how much we hate people mm-hmm. of color. And it's interesting because I was actually at a talk that Alicia Garza, who started Black Lives Matter, did, and she said, America loves everything about black people, about black culture, except for the actual people. You love Michael Jordan, mm-hmm. you love, you know, Michael Jackson, you love the way that we dress, but you don't actually love us, and you are afraid of us. And I was giving someone this example yesterday. My husband, he's from Brooklyn, and we live in D.C., you know, tough accent, big guy, and he came to pick me up from work. I work right across the street from the White House at 11 o'clock. And he had on a black hoodie that said, "We out," you know, signed Harriet Tubman. And he had on a Yankees hat. And I said, "Baby, you're gonna have to choose one or the other. You can't have on the hat and the hoodie. Because unfortunately, you coming to pick me up from our, you know, our job, because he works there too, that is dangerous for you to be driving around in Washington, D.C. with a hoodie and a hat on." And that's just a reality that we have. And so that's the reason why I think it's okay for us to say America does have a race problem. It's not to say that everyone is racist. It's not to say that all police officers are racist. I would never even assert that. But for us to act like there is not an implicit and an explicit bias, because mm-hmm. we have someone on television talking down to Muslims, Mexicans, women, and black people, and mm-hmm. has truly unearthed everything wrong with this country that's running for president, and we're all kind of okay with it. You know, the other day I was at the National, the new Smithsonian, the African American one, where I literally walked through an exhibit of police officers hosing down black people. So for us to act like that happened 400 years ago, mm-hmm. as opposed to last week, right? Like 30 years ago, 40 years ago, the same fear perhaps that police officers have when they go, they put on their uniform and they say, "I want to do this job, I want to serve my community, and I want to make sure that I make it home." That's the same fear that I have as a black person. And so for me, that's the reason why we have to be comfortable and okay saying some people are jerks. Some people are racist. Sometimes in all of our professions, not just policing, but in teaching, mm-hmm. in nursing, in your garbage man might have a race problem. And we have to be more comfortable saying, yeah, maybe that could be it. It might not be it, but it could be it. And if we actually just addressed that piece of it, I actually think that we could get a lot further faster.
My answer?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, again, we should, you know, the way I look at this is I go into a precinct, you go to talk to the cops, I'm looking for the moderate cop. We have an extremist conversation in the country at this point. It makes a lot of people on the extremes feel good, but you have a country divided down the middle, and I think even the Democratic Party is divided 9 different ways now. And I'm sort of an amateur student myself of UK politics. Anybody else follow UK politics, which is a total train wreck, right? Because you have Brexit, they were going to teach the Europeans, and nice going with that. You might take the world economy down, right? And Jeremy Corbyn, love him or not, what a train wreck that whole situation is, right? So so he's making all these points, and he's unelectable, and he's digging in further and further and further. His members of parliament don't support him. These are real issues. I'm doing these, frankly, these days because I think we're really in danger with our democracy. There's a lack of civic knowledge, and there's too much partisanship in the sense that we're not offering up solutions. So in Chicago the other day, and people, I do believe people want solutions, but in Chicago the other day, again, my two abolitionist co-panelists, one, what do you say to people in a city where 600 people have been murdered this year, 3,000 people have been shot? What is the solution to that? And there is a deafening silence. There's a deafening silence. There is no solution to that. And when you say, who is going to be in the police force? Nobody wants the job. What's the solution to that? Deafening silence, because people want to go back over the side. I got the conversation. I got it. And I you can never have enough of it because it's all true. But how do you protect people in a place like Chicago? Or literally, by the way, look at the cities where hundreds of thousands of people have left the inner cities, black middle-class people, Latino middle-class people, because of safety issues, because of a perception that they're not safe. How many people left Chicago because of police abuse, not to minimize police abuse? How many people left Chicago because, I'll just quickly say this to you. I just happened to be in the Dirksen Federal Building in Chicago the other day. There's a gang called the Hobos who are on trial. Seven people who killed nine people. You had to see the security at this trial. You would have thought it was Al-Qaeda. It was a little bit over the top. But these were people that just absolutely ran roughshod over the south side and the west side of Chicago. By the way, now the Fourth Amendment, it's a glorious time for the Fourth Amendment in Chicago because the cops aren't doing anything at this point, right? The cops get there when they get there, and that, which is also, of course, outrageous. And again, this is the moderation we need. How do you fix these things? How do you look people in the eye who just lost their kids? You want to have a political statement? You want to talk about Karl Marx? How do you look people in the eye who just lost their kids? And this has been raging now. How many people have been murdered in Chicago since 1994? 23,000. And then you hear people say, disingenuously, racial profiling in Chicago. How many of those victims in Chicago were white? And by the way, how many were black females? Very few of them, too. That is a black and brown genocide that has happened in that city. 22,000 people, and I'm sorry. You're just going to flash forward over that? There's no solution to that? Now, the police may have been part of the problem, but if you don't think the police are helpful, what is the solution?
Go ahead.
I want an answer to it. How do you protect people? Where do you get the cops from?
Let Carmen answer.
But I think that what I'm hearing, and I presume that you don't mean this in a derogatory way, because you keep using Chicago as an example, but we decide as a country you said it before, the police they are serving so many roles, right? Roles that they shouldn't have to serve. But unfortunately in this country, we always assert that it's blacks and Latinos that have all the problems, but yet our cities aren't necessarily, investing in cities like Chicago to figure out what the problem is. But when white folks in Rhode Island and New Hampshire, and I'm sure right here in New York City, are on heroin and are also committing crimes, because I'm sure that if you're not working and you're on heroin, you sometimes have to commit crimes to get to your drug. Now it's a national emergency to the point that the Democratic and the Republican Party are saying, hey, we have to address this. So I think, again, that's where race comes in, where, look, I'm sure you know the statistics. Yes, black folks kill black folks. Latinos kill Latinos. Asians kill Asians. Mm-hmm. White people kill white people. Mm-hmm. But as a country, we make a determination of, and I'm going to go there, whose life is worth us putting the funding into in order to fix the problem. And that's why I feel like it's about the police, but it's also about, as a nation, how are we going to deal with the race problem? Because it's troubling to me that we're not actually talking about, hey, the majority of people that have been killed by the police this year haven't even necessarily been black. They've been white. Right? Mm-hmm. So white people get killed by the police too. But there's this narrative that like black folks and other people of color are just inherently running around killing each other and murdering each other when, there's also a lot of issues with drugs. And and we say at the AFL-CIO and our criminal justice team, there's just as much crack cocaine on Wall Street as there is right down the street from where I work. So how are we dealing with those issues?
Okay. Did you want to respond to any of this?
Yeah, I just wanted to two points. One is around Chicago. I mean, I don't want to stay stuck in Chicago because I'd love to also talk about New York or other parts of the country. But with Chicago, I don't think we can talk about Chicago without thinking about the fact that Chicago was found that the police department was found to have been torturing people for decades. I mean, that's actually a huge problem when you want to talk about whether or not people will call the police. It's not just something you can. It's not the far, far past. It's actually not really that far past. And so when you look at Chicago, you can't take that out of the conversation and make believe it just, I'm not saying you're intentionally making believe, I think, anyway. But the other piece I did want to say is that I think that our notion of how safety is created has to get broader than it's just police. Safety has never been created just by police. If we look at New York City or in other parts of the country, and I'm not saying police who are being constitutional and respecting people's human rights don't have a role in that, but safety is not 100% police. In New York, at some of the height of some of the street organization violence, there were people who actually brokered truces between street organizations. That helps to decrease violence. When actually neighbors around a block decide that they're going to actually take action around things, that's helped to decrease violence. And I think that there's a much broader conversation we need to have about what will keep us safe and how we think about safety. The one thing I'm just going to ask you to do is, can I take 5 seconds?
You take all the time you want.
Can everybody just close your eyes for a moment? I promise I'm not going to come around and pull your hair. Nothing's going to happen. Just close your eyes for 5 seconds, and I'm going to just ask you to think about something. Think about feeling safe right now. Think about what your body temperature is. Think about what you're smelling. Think about where you are. Who are you with? And just what's the feeling and emotion that you're having? The temperature. And you're completely safe. I'm going to ask you to open your eyes. As all of you did that, how many of you thought about an officer next to you? So all I'm saying is that we can think about safety differently.
You don't have to think about the hospital system to know it's there if you need it. And you don't have to be an extremist to believe that if you didn't have police here, the rule of law would really be taking a beating. If anybody been to a country where there is no rule of law? Okay. Are there such places where there's no rule of law at all? Are there parts of America where there's no rule of law?
One of the things that I think all the panelists are saying, and Carmen, you've kind of opened this door pretty wide, is that a lot of the problems that are identified as policing are not solved within the context of a given police department. Mm-hmm. There are societal issues that are involved in that. So I'm going to try to group together several questions, and then maybe we can have a conversation about them. Joel Schwartz sent this one up. I worked in a New York psych center for 33 years. The issue of staff committing violence on the patients was something we took on consciously. It made a huge difference. Police should be represented. They should have due process. But they separate themselves from the people in the community because they've never found their voice when it comes to denouncing bad cops or racism within their ranks. Police would have more support if they didn't act like they were all perfect. The other one, and this is, again, to all the panelists. This is Angelita Marta Newhouse. She's a Local 3 member. To all the panelists and police union members in particular, as a former police academy instructor, do you think that there should be a way to get persons out of the police force who are so afraid of people of color that they react to them with violent, fearful aggression? Third part. The first one wasn't really a question. And this is, again, for all. The conversation often is just about training. Mm-hmm. What are the limits of training in creating just policing? So, Gene, I'm going to let you react to that first, because you're the one here that's actually worked at the training academy, and give us some perspective on it.
Sure, and again, I want to assure everybody here that I'm not as emphatic as I usually, but I'm trying to be the person who's not the other people. But if I was not the person who is the other people, I'd be a lot more like the other people. But because I don't think it's a consistent orthodox mindset. I think it's a case-by-case basis. Policing in New York is totally different than Chicago because of real estate, right, mostly. We've had a real estate renaissance, you go through all that. But I'll take one, and maybe, because I don't want to talk too much. The one about getting people out of the police department, we got to figure out how to get people into the police department, right? So what's the answer to that? Anybody in the audience know how we get, not the best and the brightest, because who's going to become a cop after the last 3 years? They will in suburbia. Fort Lee, New Jersey, where they're paying $130,000, but in Ferguson and St. Louis and places where you actually need outstanding people that see it as a ministry, who's going to do it after this characterization? Dallas. Remember the feel good story in Dallas that after the cops were killed, people were going to sign up. Actually, there's been a huge exodus out of the, including the chief, by the way, he left also. So and I could do the other two, but I don't want to talk.
So I guess for me, the question that's raised to your point about people exiting the profession is, then what needs to change? Because to me, mm-hmm. that means that a change needs, I mean, even with the labor movement, not just like police unions, with the labor movement, there's been, an exodus. And what we're facing right now in the labor movement is, people are retiring, people you know, have figured out different jobs. They've gone on to private sector jobs. And so we've had to look at ourselves and say, well, what the hell is our problem? That, you know, more young people, more people of color, you know, more people, you know, who have degrees or don't have degrees, they don't want to join the labor movement. And so for me, that is the question that really came to mind when I thought there's this mass exodus. But to me, I still feel like, and you know, hell, I work for the union. So for me, I understand that it is so important for there to be due process mm-hmm. for a worker, even if they're wrong as two left shoes. Mm-hmm. But let's face it, and I hate to use this example, but if a teacher molests a child, mm-hmm. we do not say, as a society, we don't blame the child, one, and mm-hmm. two, I mean, the union still has to protect that teacher. And still has to say, okay, we're going to take them through the process. We're going to figure out how we're going to put them on suspension. But what we don't do is blame all of the kids for wearing a short skirt. Like, mm-hmm. that's not how we're supposed to respond to it. And so, to you know, in line with our conversation around law enforcement, I'm really interested to understand how can we support law enforcement in saying, I know that we have a couple of bad actors. How do we deal with the bad actors? Because even at my job, there are some people that I know ain't doing they job. They ain't doing their job right. And so for me, is it a conversation? Is it, you know, I'm in management, right? So there's only so much that I can do. But how? But I'm trying to figure out for all of us, how can I support us so that the weakest link is not dragging down the rest of us so that we can be a little bit more productive? And that's one of the questions I want to have answered.
Would you mind if I know you're next, but I just want to click because this is a good one. To the outsider, the police are all powerful. You know, in this is the greatest lesson. Anybody here have friends or relatives who become cops? You may have some people that are going to be authoritarians, and they think they're going to be out there running around. And you know, by the way, 90% of the NYPD cops in a survey said they would not recommend the job to anybody. But because they all, here's the thing: the cops always say it's different when you get in there. And what do they mean? Well, it actually turns out to be one of the most bullying, demeaning, intimidating, disempowering workplaces you could think of. And the violations of the human dignity of the police, you can't even begin to document that. Does that manifest itself in conduct on the street? I did human dignity training in Africa. I have an oak down about it. If you turn, and this again, you know, and some of this is not going to be consistent. You may have to have reform, but then you're going to have to get people. I don't know where they're going to come from. Doesn't mean you don't have to have reform. But I do find it ironic that people on the left think they're going to bully, intimidate, scare, threaten, fire, criminalize people into being good employees. I find that to be ironic. And I actually do think this is where the labor movement could talk about Dr. King in Memphis, the garbage man strike, how he actually was a trailblazer for collective bargaining rights for cops. So there's a lot of common ground. But to the outsider, the cops have power. To the inside, the thing that cops hate is not the public. They hate their institutions. Mm-hmm. They hate the organizations. Because they treat them like infants. Their institutions, yeah, they infantilize the cops. They treat them like they're 10 years old, including, by the way, with 40 pages of use of force guidelines, which you might have to have. So these are the inconsistencies. You might have to have them, but the cops feel like no matter what I do now, I'm going to be wrong. They're going to dust off an old codicil, page 37. And I think people in this room can understand who represent other members of labor. If you've worked in an organization like that where they're going to flip, something happened, somebody's got to be scapegoated, somebody's got to pay. And has anybody seen the New York Police Department patrol guide? So there's a rule for everything when something goes wrong. Meanwhile, they break the rules to get the job done every day.
Let you aren't get in here.
And I'm sorry, yeah.
No, that's fine. I think I'll just respond to the training question then, which was whether or not training.
Often the conversation is about training and basically what are the limits of it or what could be done.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I'll use New York as an example. A lot has been said by the mayor and the police commissioner about how there's been new training and how important it is. And what we've heard from both officers as well as folks in the community is that yeah, we think the training is important. Although most of the cops will say the training is bullshit. That's a whole other conversation, but. The training is important, but it doesn't replace, it's not the actual solution to the system. And where we might disagree and you might be surprised, we might agree where you might be surprised is that I've got a lot of questions around body-worn cameras, and so do most of the groups in the city who do police accountability work. That's a separate question, because that's also not the silver solution or the clear solution. But on the training piece, if somebody, if you think about any other profession, yes, people go through training. But then after the formal training, the real training is how they're supervised in the field, whatever profession we're talking about, and what that looks like, how they're evaluated. And if people are not evaluated consistent with what the expectations of public service is, then that's part of what's going to happen. Or the other part of training is when people see that officers who brutalize people continue to get promoted, that actually is part of the training. It's just not called training. And so if we, or if we're going to talk about training, we've got to think about it broadly. The last thing I want to say on training is that there's a big push out of, there's implicit bias training that's going to be happening or has been started to happening at the NYPD. In many ways, that's a really good thing. But if there's not a pre and a post test, meaning like, so what that somebody goes through a training? Let's say there's a pretest. My understanding is Phil Goff is designing a pretest and a post test. Let's say there's a pretest of what somebody's assumptions and attitudes around race before they go into the training. They come out of the training and there's a post test to see whether or not there's any change. Now, for folks who fail the post test, what happens to them? Because that's never talked about, meaning the only assumption is that they've gone through a process, not that there's an outcome and behavior change. Does that make sense? So if there's not accountability attached to this at every step of the way, and I don't think that means only punishment. I think accountability also means supporting people to do their best job. So if there's no accountability all across the way, then training doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, but, I'll do it quick because I know there's other questions. You have to get real here, and you really got to understand the police world. The default setting in many police departments is to do nothing. It is the exceptional cops out there that do a lot of the work. Has anybody ever lived in a precinct that's totally useless? Where, I mean, Staten Island gets cited a lot as a precinct where you call the cops, they never come. And actually, the way policing is set up is avoiding conflict. You have so many incentives now to avoid conflict, even though the job is conflictive and adversarial. So many opportunities to just avoid. And you could cite cities like Detroit where the cops come, the response time's like an hour. You have departments where they don't chase anybody for anything ever. And you've got a handful of cops, used to, I don't know if you still do, but they would run around out there. They would come if you were in a precinct. Ironically, in some of the busier precincts, you had the best cops running to the jobs, running to the calls. Some of them probably no doubt were abusive. But you have now, in policing in America, you have such a long list of reasons not to engage anybody. You're going to take racial data. Forget about physical. I mean, the irony here is the cops were willing to be hurt, but now hurt is like third to them. Now being criminalized, demonized, accused, investigated, and the culture now in the police business is, this is a really interesting thing to hear. Why did you get involved in this? Okay, and you have whole departments, Milwaukee, where departments, and you end up with a Department of Employment. And if you're an abolitionist, this is great, but if you're a person that's been, hasn't gotten a night's sleep in 2 years because there's a noise problem, it's not great, okay? So these are real issues that you gotta, I'm paving over a lot of nuance here myself, so this is the nature of talking quickly because New York City's got a lot of we're like Mayberry in a lot of ways, but not all together, and when I ask my students that they feel safe, a lot of them say they don't. These are real issues.
Yeah, I'm going to switch gears for a minute. We have a question from someone from Brownsville, so I figure we throw it in. I grew up in Brownsville in the 1980s, and we frequently needed immediate assistance. Why can't we have both policing and investment? And these go to policy questions, so I'm going to start with you.
I mean, I think it goes back to this budget question, right? And what Carmen said in terms of how we invest, there's under-resourcing and complete disinvestment from communities and public infrastructure across the country, communities of color in particular, that's gone on for the past several decades. If we look at what's called the war on drugs, that's actually a war on people of color and black communities in particular. And that instead of actually doing what we are seeing right now with different kinds of drug use in Staten Island, for example, in white communities, there's a different treatment around that, where it's treated as a public health issue. Why can't we treat it as a public health issue across the board for anybody? And if we were to do that, that actually changes who responds, it changes what the response is, and it actually changes what our investment is in that community, because that means we're investing in the people individually and as a community to be healthy and well. And actually, in many ways, long-term for any of our communities or any of our cities across the country, having actual strong communities that are invested in, that are resourced, is actually probably the long-term solution to safety.
You know, I'm it's interesting. As soon as I got off the bus, I saw a marijuana looked like a food truck. And I took a picture of it because I sent it to my husband.
Lollipops.
Because I said, oh my God, you know, you can buy weed like it's a taco here. But then, you know, when I'm in Georgia or in Florida, you know, this is seen as a misdemeanor. You know, depending on how much you have, it could be seen as a felony. So back to the point, you know, the point is, I think you're right. The police, they are instructed to enforce the rule of law. And so perhaps the question that we should be asking ourselves is, are there some laws that need to change? Because sometimes when I'm traveling around the country and I go to a place like Seattle or a place like Denver, and I can not be from there and get an ounce of weed. But in Washington, well, maybe not in D.C., but I live in Maryland. In Maryland, I can have that same ounce, and it be worth me going to jail, perhaps losing my job. I mean, that's a question that we really need to be asking ourselves. And so, you know, I think that it has, unfortunately, put police in a precarious situation, because at the end of the day, if it's your job to arrest somebody because they got an ounce of weed, that's your job to arrest somebody because they have an ounce of weed. But as we're going into this election cycle, and I've been so frustrated because people are talking about the enthusiasm gap, I do not care if you are enthusiastic about politicians. I am enthusiastic about making sure that my kid doesn't get shot when he walks to school. I'm enthusiastic about making sure there's a grocery store in my neighborhood. I'm enthusiastic about making sure these potholes get off the roads. And so for me, I think that's really how we should be pressuring politicians and talking about politics, particularly when it comes to the criminal justice system. Because the reason why there's 800% increase in women over the past 30 years being incarcerated is because there's more ways to get in trouble. And so, unfortunately, who gets caught up are the police officers that are enforcing, unfortunately, some whack laws. There are some laws that really make sense, and then there are some laws like my taillight being out. Perhaps that might be a whack law. Maybe I shouldn't go to jail because my taillight is out.
But this is a great con. I'll do it quick. But this is a great conversation, because this is exact. Now we're getting into the nitty gritty here, which is that maybe in this room there's a group. You know, we can sort of have more of a consensus. Go outside this room and see what the consensus is. You're going to see it breaks down really quick. And block to block, street to street, building to building. Certainly, again, I know Chicago pretty well, but just not to overdo them. But if you go into neighborhoods in Chicago, there are street signs put up by the residents, and Vladimir Putin would blush. He's been used a lot in the last 24 hours. But the things we don't want on our block, it would knock you down. Some of it's unenforceable. But this is the sentiment of people living in the poorest neighborhoods. Anybody been to Chicago, you've seen these on the west side. Welcome to my block. We don't want this. We don't want this. We don't want this. We don't want that. This is the neighborhood. In terms of drugs, I know that some people think that marijuana legal. I mean, I'm probably in this category myself. But just because we're convinced marijuana is not a problem, do not accept for a minute that is an easy sell. And I don't necessarily think that's an easy sell in a poor neighborhood either. Telling people, oh, pot is okay, just hand it out wherever you want to hand it out. I'm not sure that's such a big sell either. Near a schoolyard, go try to sell that in the neighborhood and tell people that's okay. The U.S. Attorney, final thing I'll say, U.S. Attorney Preet Bharara, Obama appointee, big news last week, knocked me off the chair. He is instructing the NYPD at the scene of heroin overdoses to treat them like crime scenes. The federal government wants to prosecute for murder drug dealers. I think this is a little ridiculous, but this is the Obama administration. He was giving out pardons and trying to do the right thing, because, and the issue of, I mean, Bernie was talking about opioid abuse in an emotional way, because he's running into it. And the idea that just a health, health approach is gonna work, just gotta be careful not to get so cul-de-sac in our own thinking that, you go outside in the community, you never go to a community meeting and not get surprised with people. You go to Brownsville, people have, stereotyped neighborhoods, and you will hear people get up and yell about, they will. Not, I'm not saying it's a big issue, but, what's the issue? Washing the car, somebody's washing their car on my street. And you would think, well, maybe in that neighborhood there were bigger issues. Why can't this person demand the same rights on his street, on Pitkin, as people get on a sudden place? Does he not have a right to have the same levels of safety, subject to the whole neighborhood, which, again, if you get into If you have 30 people, you're probably going to have 30 different, you know, opinions.
Okay, I'm going to, again, switch directions. This is a question for Carmen. But anybody can jump in. We're all here. What is the likelihood that the AFL-CIO will take substantial action, a leading role, in connecting the demands of the Black Lives Matter movement with the interests of the labor movement?
Well, I feel like we already have. You know, I mean, we, you know, as someone that, you know, I'm proudly a part of the organization, you know, outside of my job at the AFL-CIO, the Black Youth Project 100, I actually feel like the AFL-CIO has done a great job towing the line between we represent law enforcement and we're not kicking them out, and we absolutely have to figure out how we're going to work with law enforcement, and saying that Black lives certainly do matter because your civil rights director is Black and is affected by these issues every single day. You know, if you look at the vision for Black Lives that came out over the summer, you know, one of the things that they articulate really well is that Black folks, you know, one, there's this misnomer that we're all poor, you know, and that none of us have any home training. But, you know, I think the number one thing that, you know, all communities care about is jobs. They care about mm-hmm. jobs, benefits, wages, taking care of their families, education. And so I actually feel like, you know, from the AFL-CIO's perspective, we have been working very closely with the movement for Black Lives to not only make sure that that they understand that we support their stance on collective bargaining, that we support their stance on how we want to advance the Black community. Because let's face it, one of the reasons why there is, you know, substantial crime in our community is because of mass incarceration, which is directly connected back to the fact that we don't have jobs. If white folks are at 4% unemployment, Black folks are at 8%. You know, when the United States was at an 8% unemployment rate, that was a crisis. That was a recession. But when it's for Black people, oh, that's just kind of like business as usual. So I think, you know, perhaps we don't always do the best job articulating the relationship that we have or the relationship that we want to have with the movement for Black Lives. And I think that's for a number of reasons, primarily of which we're represented by 55 affiliates. And, you know, every affiliate is not necessarily jazzed that, you know, we're working with the movement for Black Lives. But I will say this, as the person that has the pleasure of working with that community of people, I actually feel like they want to have transformative justice and reconciliation too, and are looking to figure out, we're looking to figure out together, how can we reform the criminal justice system, because we truly feel like if we start with the issues with the criminal justice system, we actually won't have as many problems as we currently have.
Anybody else want to comment on that? Okay, I'm going to, this is a, goes a little bit of a follow-up. We've gotten several questions along the same way, and Jean, you may want to jump in on this too. Several questions on the union side. One is very simple. Should police unions be part of the AFL-CIO, which we did raise a little bit in the introduction. And then there's a question from UAW Local 2825. The local passed a resolution which condemned the AFL-CIO's affiliation with police unions precisely for the reasons you have mentioned as to why it's dangerous to be a minority, race, gender, et cetera, in America with regards to police zealotry. I was wondering if there's a comment, stance from the AFL-CIO on these types of calls from the rank and file. Any discussion at the higher levels about some of them?
You know, anytime an affiliate, you know, challenges the AFL-CIO and other affiliates, I mean, we take that very seriously, extremely seriously, and we have very long discussions about it. But again, you know, and I'm saying this as a representative of the AFL-CIO, we are not in the business of kicking people out. We're in the business of protecting workers and protecting workers' jobs. And so really, that's the reason why the labor movement has to talk to the labor movement. If UAW is talking to, you know, our brothers and sisters in law enforcement about the intricacies and the nuances of collective bargaining contracts, that's powerful. If we kick them out, then they're having a conversation by themselves. I mean, a part of the problem is some of the police unions aren't a part of the AFL-CIO. So then we can't actually have this, we can't have this conversation because they don't show up to the Central Labor Council meeting. But if they show up to the Central Labor Council meeting, then we can at least push each other. I have spent the past year and a half having conversations on race, and it's been difficult. And there were days where I said, I need to get me a new job that's a little bit easier than this. But you know what I learned? If The IBEW isn't having a difficult conversation with the Communication Workers of America, then that conversation would have never happened. And so I think that is one of the reasons why we take that stance, outside of the fact that police officers are workers. So how do we call them in and not kick them out? And that is the stance of the AFL-CIO.
Could I just say, if anybody caught Rachel Maddow last night with Souter speaking, really interesting, about Souter saying civic ignorance is killing the country. And he said it would lead to the rise of a strong man. I think if you take a long view, it's a really bad idea to undermine the police as an institution and demonize the people that do the work. I think that's a bad idea. And time will show that that's a bad idea. And the civic ignorance comes in when you have somebody who means well who says, why can't the police be treated like everybody else when it comes to using force? Police can't be treated like everybody else because that's the job that they do on our behalf. We don't run to the apartment for the lady. They go to the apartment for the lady. Somebody here could come up with a better, and again, there are better solutions, but that's the default setting. They use force, including deadly force, coercive force. That is their job. It's not their only job, but that is a unique job in civilian life. My view, it's morally cowardly to give the cops that responsibility and then disown your responsibility. So unless you have a better plan for getting, I mean, the police pull somebody over to enforce our laws that we pass, the taillight, and they ask for your license, that is a demand, right? That is not a request. And that, is that me speaking? That is our system. Are you free to leave? When you get pulled over for a red light, are you free to leave? It may shock people to know you're under arrest, right? When you get a ticket, it's in lieu of arrest. It's our system. So we can go on a little bit, you know, I don't want to belabor it. Our political system is really in trouble. Politicians are lowly regarded for a reason. They've played a terrible role with this police stuff. They run for cover or grandstanded. They're the ones that, how many laws do they pass every year in Albany without repealing any laws, okay? And they want to lay that on the feet of the police. And ultimately, again, extremism begets extremism. The Trump phenomenon is on fire in the law enforcement community at this point. Those of us that think that's a tragedy and a terrible thing, we got to work to get some stuff to use to bring people into the middle. We have one big divided country at this point. And again, I think the for poor people, undermining the police is going to turn out to be some form of our Brexit, because a lot of what they do is just peacekeeping. A lot of what they do is just service. They're doing stuff with missing persons. They're doing stuff with the elderly. And you're destroying the profession, demonizing them. 15 of them were assassinated because it got so personal and embittered. And I'm not, you know, we can have a conversation or not about that. But we have to own our society. Otherwise, we are going to all break down. And what Souter said was, and it may not be this strong man who will come along, he predicted, this is a four-year-old interview, a strong man will come along, right? That there will. That's what he said. He keeps him up at night. Anybody saw the interview?
Yeah.
Keeps him up. I won't tell Rachel when I see her that nobody watches her show at that hour of the night. But he said that's what keeps him up at night, is that an emergence of a strong man who will say, I will handle this.
Julian, this is for you.
Can I just make one comment to that, which is that, you know, I agree that the Fraternal Order of Police endorsing Trump is a sign of extremism. I don't think that calling for accountability is a sign of extremism. And I hear what you're saying, but most of the people in this country who've been talking about the need to change the system, especially in terms of the way the system of policing in this country and the lack of accountability, that's not an extremist position. That's a position to try to make, to try to save lives. I mean, I guess I just want to leave it at that. That's not an extremist position.
Well, this question might get us in a little deeper. It's for you. At least I'm deciding it's for you. If people don't want to be cops anymore, and cops don't like their work, we are looking at a need for a deep market and culture change. What can be done to change the culture of a department of public employees whose job it is to serve and protect? Can the police departments be agents of change?
Could the police departments be agents of change? I mean, I've heard this question before. I think when, and what I do is I go to talk to officers about it to say, do you think the department can be an agent of change? And what they will often say is actually not so different from what you said earlier in terms of how they're treated by their supervisors and the institutional culture within the police department being really challenging for change. What I do think, though, is that there can be change that happens, but what we have right now is a situation where officers who speak out about speak out against other officers when they witness or when they believe there's either abuse or brutality, that they're ostracized. The whistleblowers are completely ostracized. And so an example I'll bring is that there's, you know, there's 12 police officers, we shorthand them as the NYPD 12, who are suing the department right now over what they say are a quota system that forces them to do tickets and arrests of Black and Latino communities around things that are not enforced in the same way in predominantly white communities. And that's actually a labor issue. That's a quota issue. And they are, many of them, especially the ones who have not been as public, have been retaliated against within the department for speaking out. They're ostracized, they're isolated, and they fear for their safety at different times. And so I think that we're talking about a very big system. Before the department itself can be that kind of leader around change, there needs to be some in-house cleanup.
Okay, anybody else want to comment on that?
Can I just quickly, criminal justice reform is really hard, and it's really slow. And when you decide you're not going to let people, you say, it's like if anybody knows the parole board, you're going to let somebody out. Everybody knows that's a risk, right? And when you're on the parole board, you're taking risks. And we have seen some people who've gotten out do some horrible things. The point is, having a conversation with and about cops individually is a relatively easy, no skin in the game conversation. I think there's as many people more or less in prison now since with this president leaving as there was when he came. The idea that you could just do these easy criminal, you know, again, the legislature, why are they not clearing up some of these laws? Why are they not repealing some of these laws? Because there is a constituency for the police. So,
right, but doesn't that beg the question, though? Yeah. And someone from the audience has asked this, and this is probably a time to inject it. The failure of the police union leadership to lead on criminal justice reform and anti-racism, hiding behind their obligation to defend their members, is part of the reason that many of us paint the police with a broad brush, and a large part of the problem and not part of the solution. What is the responsibility of the police unions in this? I mean, we had Reverend Sharpton on a different panel about a year ago here, and he did make the point, and I know he's a controversial figure in all of these discussions in New York, but he made a very interesting point. He said in every instance of police firing a weapon that's been disputed by the community, not one time has an organized police union come out and said that the officer was wrong. Now, we get the duty of fair representation, the obligation of membership, but it goes to this question.
Well, and the police chiefs just said this week, we apologize for how we've treated people of color. So, I mean, there's actually been an acknowledgement, perhaps not by the union.
That's a management association.
But by law enforcement, that there is a problem here. And I think, you know, also just as I've been listening to this conversation, I want to name it, you know, we've been kind of talking, you know, one of the things that I learned through this process with the Race Commission is what is racism, right? Because when you think about racism, we always go straight to malicious racism. We go to somebody with a hood and the KKK and, you know, a Confederate flag, as opposed to the coded racism. Because when I hear poor people, right, this dichotomy between poor people and then everybody else, I'm just hearing black and brown people. And so to me, I think that that's really a part of the retrain. And it's not just a training, it's the rethinking of how we think about people of color in America. Because it's not just the poor people, AKA, I guess me, maybe you. You know, it's not just the poor people that need to change. It's everybody. Rich white people break the law too. And I've actually seen them break the law. But because they have really great attorneys, because they have connections, they've been able to figure out how to maneuver the system. Even marijuana. So some of us are still in jail for things that we've done on marijuana. And some of us are making millions of dollars in states like Colorado off of marijuana. So I think that, again, it would be really great, you know, for us to open up this conversation around how does race play a part in policing, because we all know it does. And it would be interesting to see how the police chiefs work with the unions to get them to a place where they can articulate, yes, there are inconsistencies in how we talk about people of color and how we treat people of color.
Could I just say quickly, one thing I learned in this conversation is that extremism is fueled when you leave facts out. And this is what happens when people go to their corners. So when the media was doing only black people being shot by white cops, and I know they did it, and they did it really, even though many more white people are shot than African Americans, I think some people on the left thought, well, people on the right, and I hate to do the left, right, because I actually don't think these things are at all ideological. We got to fix the country. We got to fix the country. Got to own the country. Got to own people being killed, no matter where they are. But I think some on the left think if they just stay in an echo chamber and talk to each other, that the people on the right are not going to pull up these murder maps. And I hate having these conversations, but we have to have honest conversations. When you're talking about the cops, you know, as though they're racial profiling, the New York City Police Department has the capacity now to put crimes that occur in the city on a map. It is a relatively small number of streets in the city when you actually put those crimes on a map. I don't know for sure the racial dynamics, but if you look at poverty and all that stuff, I would guess what the racial dynamics are. Now you put the cops on the block and you accuse them of racial profiling. That's really disingenuous. Now, that could be. I mean, I don't want to oversimplify it, but that's the kind of stuff that we have to be.
Yeah.
There's this glossing over of we're taking these logical jumps, and people are just continue to be digging into these comments. And I saw this a lot, and if you dealt with the media, the media 3 years ago decided for ratings, and I'm not saying it's not a real issue, but they absolutely, and you know, this is why Trump's got all these people saying the media is dishonest, and this is why the media is one of the least respected institutions, because they actually do run with stuff for the soul, for division purposes, particularly for racial division purposes, and I got the calls. They would say, what's the race of the shooting? The last few shootings happen to be African-American cops doing the shootings. So that is the end of MSN. They're not going to do those because they don't fit into the narrative. So, but that crosses ideological. Everybody's got their own facts that they want to trot out, throw out there. Let's try to get a real picture, try to fix the country. We should own people being shot by anybody in the country everywhere. I mean, it shouldn't matter. Shouldn't say, oh, that's Chicago. You know, we don't care. You know, there are fellow citizens that are being killed in these cities that, you know, don't have a voice. A lot of them are young. And, you know, we need some sort of interventionist program. We need a really aggressive plan to go in and rescue these kids that are really, you know, that have whatever the issues are, you know, are picking up guns and again, we don't talk about personal responsibility. And, you know, the president, they've done nothing with Wall Street, as far as I can tell, in 8 years. And if you want to racially profile, you ever see those hearings when the people are brought in? It's like all white people, right? So that's a whole other. Why hasn't this administration done anything to corporate America? They absolutely run roughshod over everybody.
All right, I'm going to cut that here.
I think that's kind of the example. I mean, and I think that starts to segue into the example of the way in which laws are enforced are racially discriminatory in this country, period, and full stop. And then if we talk about New York, or there's two things I want to say. One is that on this point that you've made a few times now that, I think both of you have made, that white folks are killed more by cops than black folks. Nuance in that, though, is that the percentage of black folks who are killed by cops who are unarmed, as opposed to white folks who are armed. I mean, we're not talking about equal situations here in terms of when officers are able to not kill somebody, I guess is what I'm going to say in these situations. But if I come back to New York around the ways in which, I don't think the question is, are individual cops racist? It's just not the primary question. Like, that sucks. There are some individuals, but just like in any profession, that sucks. The big issue is the systemic piece. So when you look at how laws are applied in New York, and we'll just take a few examples of what gets talked about as broken windows policing. Open container on a sidewalk. So if I look at the map that was just referred to, it's going to see where open container is enforced. That is not the same as when an open container just means you're having alcohol somewhere publicly in a cup or a beer can or what have you. There are people in Central Park every weekend when it's still warm outside who are having champagne. That's not who's getting ticketed, and that's not showing up on the crime map. What does show up on the crime map is different neighborhoods, neighborhoods of color primarily, where people might actually be on their stoop, or there might be other situations going on. Or another example would be bicycles on the sidewalk. I live in Brooklyn. My neighborhood, if there are people in Flatbush, if there are people who have their bikes on the sidewalk, they're getting a ticket or they're getting pulled over by a cop to be talked to. Just a few miles down in Park Slope, there's always people on that. There's always young white kids on the sidewalk with their bikes. That's not who's getting ticketed, but we're not saying that those, but, and it's not as if that's not happening, but it's not going to show up on the map. Marijuana use or marijuana, possession of marijuana. Studies have shown nationally as well as in New York. Actually, white folks use smoke weed just as much as any other community, and in many cases more so, is what the research shows. But that's not who's actually getting prosecuted for possession, for any of the pieces around marijuana. And so I guess I just want to say that the facts are actually that the enforcement of the laws are racially discriminatory.
Three quick things. One.
Hold on.
Well, it's important. Thanks to 311, the cops get complaints. The Eric Garner case is a function of six people complaining. The store owner saying, so that's one. Two.
I got to say something about the Eric Garner case. Sorry. Eric Garner, who was killed by chokehold in 2014, what folks have said, who were there, including the shop owner right there, was that Eric actually was breaking up a fight. Right. He wasn't selling Lucy's.
But they showed the printout. The point, point is people do make
but
complaints.
But that's exactly the point. The point is that officers, just because they see somebody or think that they have in the past done something, doesn't give them the right to actually, in the case with Eric, to choke him to death.
What do you do when people are making
but
complaints?
But Eric wasn't doing that complaint. That complaint that day was
okay,
not
we could,
about
we could
Eric.
Go over there, but the fact is the complaints roll in from neighborhoods. They roll right in every day. And if you think you're doing, you may be doing something in a neighborhood that you think is not annoying people, you'd be surprised. Okay, you would be surprised. Sitting on your stoop having a beer will alarm a lot of people.
All right, I'm going
to do pretextual stops to try to get guns.
I'm going to end this with a question. I'm going to end this. I'm going to end this all with another question for each of you. Before I do, this is a precursor to a larger conference on this issue, which will take place in the spring. For those of you that are here that want to stay interested, if you fill out this yellow card and either leave it on the tables in the back or later on, give it to the same staff people that were collecting them, we'll make sure you're involved. Last round, I'm going to start with you because I think that we have a question that you've probably lost sleep over at some point. Police exist in all countries of the world. What makes American police different? And why are they not learning from countries that have safe societies and respectful police forces? And this is from Robel.
I mean, police in many, many countries around the world are not armed, is one thing to keep in mind. And that is a difference. It's a key difference. And I think that part of what we think about in this country is that we have a very particular history of racism, of institutionalized racism and of systemic racism. And I would agree with both of the other panelists that the issues of racism are not just in the police department, right? They're throughout society. But when we think about the ways in which law enforcement and what laws are being enforced and all that kind of stuff, a lot of that does come down actually to systemic racism, sometimes to actually other situations like with many killings. There's a high percentage of killings by police that are in response to people who are emotionally not well or are having or in basically health crises. And so a lot of this, I think, is really that we have to change how we think about what the role, how to create safety in our society, and it can't be just relying on armed officers. It just can't.
Thank you, Eugene. This is the shortest question of the night.
Sure.
What are the police doing to protect whistleblower rights? The police unions, really.
It's a hard topic because the police. I mean, to be very blunt here. Police department does not tolerate dissent. But that's not anybody shocked? Does the military tolerate? It's a quasi-military organization. So, again, which is one of the big shocks, which is a big shock for young people, right?
That's part of the problem, frankly.
Yeah, but fix it.
You're in a better position.
I'm one tiny step at a time. Okay. They don't brook dissent. And if anybody's been in the police world, you know, if you fight the police department, you're going to lose. That's just the way they are. And they'll take you now, or they'll take you later, but they'll take you. And it's whether you're blowing the whistle on something legitimate or you're, this is an organization that has, you know, rules like insubordination. So if they tell you to go stand on a sewer at 12th Avenue, and by the way, these are great things in an emergency, okay? So my beloved CUNY, my beloved colleagues, you realize if something happened tonight in the Bronx at 2 o'clock in the morning, we could have 10,000 cops there. They'd be there. They would be there. They'd come. They would be there. My beloved CUNY, imagine getting my colleagues to be somewhere at 10 o'clock. You know, they would say, where's the Bronx? The metaphorical issues. They're a command and control group of people. They show up. People can throw things at them, whatever. But it is not a culture, and it's a shock for young people. They go in and they don't really want your opinion. They don't really want your input. Believe it or not, they do a lot of things pretty well. I'm a big critic of them, but if you look at the work that they do, now in the volume of work that they do, something like EDPs, they resolve them 300 times a day without any issues. But if you blow the whistle on the police world, and I guess this is true in corporations too. And some
it's degree. Actually the truth of the matter is in the public sector in New York State anyway, it's rampant. It's more dramatic in the police departments, but public sector workers know. Mm-hmm. You blow the whistle today, you may be there, but somewhere down the road they're going to pay you back. Mm-hmm. And reprisal is a known fact on whistleblowing.
And you break the law. The thing that's really interesting, again, if you're in the organization, the best cops tonight are breaking rules all over the place to get the job done. But at any one moment, the organization could say, rule number, whatever, 6,000, whatever, and they can write you up. So.
All right, Carmen, you're going to get the last word tonight, right? You talked about having police unions affiliated with the AFL-CIO, how it creates an opportunity for conversation with them. Are there any local examples that you would hold up, places where police are engaging with other unions in those kinds of constructive conversations?
I'll give you two examples. One, I'll give you a national example. So the Communication Workers of America, they actually do have some law enforcement and some corrections officers inside of their union. They also represent, Verizon workers. You know, they also represent, a bunch of other folks within the sector. At their national convention, they really pushed to pass a resolution around, that basically spoke to Black Lives Matter. And this was not an easy conversation for them. They argued, fussed, and fought. But they were able to actually come to resolve. And they were actually able to push each other to basically see everything that he's saying, everything that she's saying, everything that I'm saying, and put it together in one place where we could actually have some conversation, which is very much so needed. So if you kick someone out, then you actually cannot have the conversation. There are things that he has said that have just made me go, oh, God. But for me, I feel like I'm really happy that we can actually be on this stage and have this discourse and dialogue, because when I go back to my office tomorrow, I'm going to be able to say, well, this is how police officers show up. This is how they think about these issues. So the next time we have a conversation, this is how we can do it differently. Can't do it if they're not a part of the AFL-CIO. Can't do it if they're not a part of the broader labor movement. That's one. The second example I'll give is in San Diego. In San Diego, they work with Border Patrol. They work with faith community. They work with actual community organizations and labor. Of course, that's going to be a difficult conversation. But they actually have a ton of, so in this instance, there are a ton of people of color that actually work for Border Patrol and work for ICE. So this is not necessarily a dynamic that's, white folks versus people of color, but really it's to what we've all spoken about, is that there needs to be some changes with the system. And so when there are issues that actually happen, they have been able to have resolve because they've been able to work through it as a coalition. So there are great examples just like that. I mean, working with between Border Patrol, police, and community in a place like San Diego, the fact that they have a coordinated coalition, it's a miracle. It can happen, but there has to be, one, an acknowledgement that there is a problem. acknowledgement that something is wrong with the system and not make up excuses that there are things that are wrong with the system, and two, a willingness on all of our parts to change.
At this point, I just want to introduce David Unger. He's got some announcements to make about where this conversation is going to go going forward. Thank you.
So first thing, I'd like to just thank everybody who came out tonight. It is a Friday night on a disgusting, disgusting evening, and there's 100-plus people in the room.
Yeah.
And I want to thank all of the panelists for coming in. This is not an easy conversation. It's one that we took on knowing that it may not work. But it's one that has to happen. This panel is also not meant as the end of anything. It really is an attempt, hopefully, to start. And from looking at the questions that came in, and we only got to probably less than half of the questions that people had. And there's 1,000 more that we still need to ask if we want to figure out how to constructively bring a conversation forward. So what we're asking from all of you, if you want to be involved in this conversation going forward, we are going to be having a conference in April, April 28th and 29th, same title, Confronting the Tragedy, Law Enforcement, Unionism, and Communities of Color, to try and dig deeper into what's going on. We're putting out a call for scholarship, a call for panel and workshop and educational proposals to present during those 2 days to bring the conversation forward. But before we get there, we're going to have, as clearly has been shown by Carmen and processes that have gone forward, we're going to have a ton of conversations between now and April if we expect April to be at all successful in moving steps forward. So each of you, when you walked in, one of the things you had is an orange card asking if you want to participate more. There's a few manners on here of ways to participate. Do you want to host a conversation, you or your organization, host a roundtable? Do you want to just participate in one? Do you have an idea of a study or a panel or something that you could use to contribute to this conversation? Do you want to engage your organization's membership around these topics? Does your organization or you want to be a co-sponsor of what we do going forward? So again, the only way we're going to make this the beginning of a conversation and the only way we're going to make it a successful one as opposed to just another panel that talked and does nothing is if we take what comes in here and we go forward with it together. So again, I want to thank the panelists. I want to thank Ed for moderating and all of you for being here.
Great to see you. Very nice to meet you.